If you've just joined us and you're wondering what on earth's happening, you're listening to Scotty McClue's Massive Mighty Megaphone In, and we are, of course, live on the country's top radio station, Scotland's number one, Lanarkshire's L107. Today, a bit of a Scotty McClue special, because we're absolutely privileged to have the world-famous actor David Heyman with us in the studio this morning. Now, David was with us about a month ago, and his acting career needs no introduction to any of you. You see him in films, you see him in the television, you see his name in theatre, all the time there, and whatever he plays, it's always a fascinating study of the character, and everybody loves to see David Heyman. But he's got many, many strings to his bow, as we know, but also he's got this terrific charity called Spirit Aid, and he's going to be talking about that this morning as well. He's also in the company of Patrick Rolink. That's the Patrick Rolink, who is a first-class stand-up comedian. But he's been asked to sit down this morning, and he's with us in the studio as well. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, Scotty.
Hi, Scotty.
How are you doing, Pat? Lovely to see you again. Now, David, you were very kindly with us a month ago, and we talked a little bit about the whole acting career, because people are fascinated by this. How does one become an actor? How does one become famous? And I can remember asking somebody about Lord Olivier and his fighting abilities on stage, his stage fighting abilities, and they said he worked at it. How much is it perspiration, and how much is it medication, and all that sort of thing? I mean, how does one become a famous actor?
Oh, Scotty, what a hell of a question. I have no answer to that whatsoever. It's luck, and it's partly luck, it's partly good judgment, it's partly being in the right place at the right time. At the end of the day, you've got to have a talent, and I believe real talent will out at some point in its life. But where you start, which doors you knock on, first of all, how on earth you get an agent, how do you tell the world that you're here, that you're talented, that you want to break? It's very, very difficult. And I think I said to you last time I was on, Scotty, there's something like 35,000 actors in the United Kingdom, and at any given point, there are only 3,000 jobs.
Jeez.
Total. That's theatre, TV, movies, radio, you name it. Only ever, on average, about 3,000 jobs. So that's well over 90% unemployment for most of the industry. It's really tough. So you have to have got... You've got to hold that dream in your heart so strongly and never ever let it go.
And therefore, if you're not getting what, Davey, you can't sort of say, is it something I've done or said? Is it the way I've spoken? Is it my accent? It's probably absolutely nothing to do with any of those.
Nothing to do with anything, Scotty. I really believe you take it for granted that most people who call themselves actors can act. It's whether you have the right face, the right size, the right feel, the right attitude. It's nothing really to do with your talent. And you'd be amazed. I mean, when I'm directing, I rarely audition people. I just kind of go on an instinct, on a hunch. Now, you'd be amazed at how many times when an actor walks through the door, you know if they've got it or they haven't got it. Absolutely extraordinary. I would lay money on it.
Now, this is even when they're not actually acting. They're just being themselves.
People have an aura about them or an energy that you just know is quite... It's compelling, that you know they would be highly watchable. There's something about it. I remember, you know, Andy Serkis, the young boy who played made his name playing Gollum in Lord of the Rings, and then he played King Kong with the same director, Jackson. So he's a world-famous actor, but nobody knows what he looks like. Now, Andy Serkis, I remember when he first walked in, I gave him one of his first real sort of starring roles years ago, 10, 15 years ago. The minute Andy walked through the door, you thought, wow, this kid's got something special. He's got a dynamic about him that I long to see on a stage, I long to put in front of a camera.
Now, so it's not necessarily something that's out. It's not necessarily a hail fellow well-met approach or anything like that. They could almost kind of slink or trudge into the room, and you still think there's something here.
Yeah, absolutely. Some of the most powerful people are the quietest ones who just sit in the corner, with a brooding kind of nature, and you think, oh, there's a power in there.
Now, that's the acting side of it. Coping with the fame. I mean, here are you, very kindly, sitting in L107 studio this morning with no side to you at all, and we know that that is you. But what do you do when there's the pressures associated with you? Your name's right up there in Broadway, flashing David Heyman, first show, live tonight, all the rest of it. What do you think to yourself? Do you ever suffer from nerves when you see that? Do you think, oh my God, the president's going to be at Broadway tonight, they're all going to be there, and I've got to go on and sing a song?
No, funnily enough, Scotty, the pressure really comes when you've got family and friends then watching you.
Ah.
Not strangers, they can be the king of bloody Portugal if you want coming
absolutely.
In. You know, all the royalty under the sun. It wouldn't faze me a bit, but if your granny was sitting in the front row, you'd go, oh my God, my granny's in, I've got to be really good tonight. You know, pull out all the stops, I don't want to disappoint my granny or my neighbour or my best pal. They're the ones that are always... Where the nerves come, the butterflies come.
And she's going to be so full of pride, your granny, but she's going to say something devastating at the end, like, I couldn't actually hear you, son.
Well, my gran's no longer with us, but she was not backward and coming forward, that's for sure, but her comments about my performances, no.
David, we're all familiar with so many of your performances. One of the ones that I've always loved was in a film, Hope and Glory.
Oh, lovely film about the Second World War.
Yes, and I just remember this wonderful moment. You were driving away with the kids in an Austin 10 or something like that, and Uncle Mac was running alongside, waving and smiling, and you were going, Mac, get away, you silly man.
His finger gets stuck
in the
door.
The wee one says, Daddy, you've shut his hand in the door. And I just thought it was just one of these beautiful, beautiful moments, you know?
It was a very, very funny moment. It's lovely. It's a very, very special film, that, I think, Scotty. It's a lovely, gentle film where I look at a family, a middle-class family in the middle of the Second World War. It was great fun to do.
Beautifully done and beautifully acted.
And Ian Bannon.
Lovely late Ian Bannon.
Ian Bannon, who was a pal of mine. I'd done about four pictures with Ian, and I loved him to death. And he's magnificent in the film. I think he steals it as the grandfather, his eccentric grandfather.
Oh, my God, your little fiends! The lovely thing, because he had that sort of wonderful characteristic in his voice as well, that gave a great depth to his character. And of course, Ian Bannon was a man that a lot of early black and white films.
Yes, he was a matinee idol in his youth. He played Hamlet at Stratford for the Royal Shakespeare Company when he was a boy. Meant to have been absolutely stunning.
Wonderful. What's your favourite sort of genre in the theatre?
Oh, I don't know. There's nothing like live theatre, Scotty. You can't compare with...
Would you prefer live theatre to films and telly?
Yes.
Right.
In other words, for the experience, for the adrenaline rush, it's the best drug in the world. The thing about it is, the audience in a piece of theatre have a contribution to make to the quality of that performance. Now, you can come and see me as Jimmy Boyle in A Sense of Freedom, the film. Your presence, you can watch that film 100 times over, your presence will not change my performance one jot. Mm-hmm. And my performance will never change because it's in celluloid. Whereas you can come along and see me play a piece on theatre, you can see it 100 times, you may very well see 100 different performances because the character, the personality of the audience dictate in many ways the course of events of an evening at theatre. You have an input. That's what makes it so special. It's a two-way process.
You must find it unusual because I've sat through theatre performances of the same play, and sometimes totally unexpectedly to me, and obviously to some of the actors, the audience would laugh at a certain point. Something got a laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And the actors must be not thrown by it, but you must be taken aback when you think, that's unusual. And then what do you do? Do you allow the laugh to go? Do you play it again?
You can't stop an audience laughing. You can't dictate to an audience how they react. If they want to laugh at something you think is being, well, you're being deeply tragic on that stage and pouring your heart out and they're pissing themselves laughing, there's nothing you can do about it. That's just the luck of the draw.
And does it throw you?
It can throw you. I mean, you can be cussing under your breath and thinking, God, how the hell have I screwed this up? What did I do wrong?
Yes, have I not got across to them that I'm suffering?
I'm grateful they are.
Yes, that's right. I'm actually suffering at the moment and they're laughing.
I remember, I'll tell a funny story. I played Hamlet at the Glasgow Sits years ago, and I played Hamlet in a jockstrap. All I wore was a wee skimpy little jockstrap.
God, I bet that got a good turnout.
But I remember, and there was a wee goonie I had to wear on top of it for the fight scene at the end, so I had to take off my goonie to reveal just a wee jockstrap. Packed audience in the Gorbo Citizens Theatre, and as I strip off this wee woman for the back, she goes, oh, it's a strip show! This is Hamlet, I bet you meet his death.
Incredible stuff.
The whole audience just go up and they, you know.
Have you ever been in something where the audience have walked out that's been so good that they're actually disgusted? You've played it so well that they think, no, that's dreadful. This
no, but I've known audiences walk out because I've been so bad.
I don't believe
any of
that.
I've ever driven an audience away by being too good, Scott.
Yeah, no. And they played it so outrageous that people were leaving. And you had old ladies going, that's just disgusting.
We had a lot of that in the early days of the sets, yes, the scandal factor.
Yeah.
No, my theatre should be about scandal.
Of course it should, shock. Yeah. Making people think. Making people think outside the box, a stimulus.
Hopefully.
Now, I saw a moment that when I was telling you about the audience laughing there, it was a Somerset mom for services rendered played at the Theatre Royal. And Phyllida Law, and there was a whole crowd in the cast there, well-known names, old Leslie Sands, and John Quayle, and all that crowd. National, I think they were National Theatre production, and she came in, this actress came in, and she absolutely shrieked that Collie is dead. And she did such a shriek. You know the kind of shriek that actresses play when Queen Victor, if they played Queen Victoria and Albert dies? And it was just this terrific, ah, he's dead! And the whole theatre fell about laughing. And I said to a guy who'd actually, well, you'll remember, Eric Jones, the director at the Oscars, I said to Eric, I said, what went wrong there? Why was everybody laughing? And he said, I think they can't take big emotion.
Oh. That's interesting.
That was an interesting one, wasn't it? Because
very interesting, yeah. Often, Scotty, people laugh through embarrassment. It's a cover-up. You know, if you expose emotions on stage or expose something dramatically, which is kind of revealing, and they see themselves in it or whatever, aspects of themselves or aspects of their lives, very often it's a nervous laugh to cover up their embarrassment of the fact that you've exposed something.
You're exposing something.
Or something in them. And I used to say that to younger actors, don't worry if you get laughs in the wrong places. They could be healthy laughs. The laughter of an audience covering up their embarrassment or their shock or their surprise at what you're doing on stage. So it's in a way, it's a backhanded compliment.
Yes, wonderful stuff. Well, very often when people do tell you that somebody's died or whatever, you go, ach away, you're joking. You know, it's such a strange reaction. As if you joke about that, you know.
Patrick is a comedian, I mean, he dies every night on stage. He still gets up the next morning.
That's wonderful. Patrick, tell me what you're up to, because I'm going to tell everyone, we're going to come on to Spirit Aid. Tell us what you're up to these days, because, I mean, you're a very funny man, and I can see that even sitting looking at you.
Well, tomorrow night I'm doing the big Spirit Aid gig in at Oranmore, which I'm really looking forward to.
Right.
This weekend I'm down in London at Jongleurs Comedy Club in Camden. And then in June I'm off to Las Vegas. I've got some gigs in the Riviera Hotel in Las Vegas in June, and then I'm in Cowdenbeath when I get back, so lots to look forward to.
Now, don't laugh at me. I mean, you know, I was a stand-up comedian, but I was asked to sit down, and
you've never got off your ass since.
I've never got off my backside since, and people I gave up because people were just laughing at me all the time. But the thing is, there's yourself out there. Now, you've had a good career as a comedian, Patrick, but it must be terribly, terribly tough. The only thing I really think goes for a stand-up comedian is that they don't need tools.
Well, I'll be perfectly honest, lots of people say, how can you do that? It's an absolute joy and a privilege to go on stage and make people laugh, and it's a buzz. You get up every morning and you look forward to your next gig. You have bad gigs, like you have bad days at work, but for me it's a humbling experience when people book you to go to places like Las Vegas or New York to make people laugh, and you come for a wee house in Skeeman Airdrie. and it shows you that if you've got talent and you work at it, no matter where you come from, you'll break through the glass ceiling that people talk about. Everybody should just go for it. Go for the dream. Have your aspirations, your hopes, because they will come true if you push hard enough.
Do you not think that the wee council scheme in Airdrie is actually the great secret to knowing exactly what life's about?
Well, I think you hit it in the head when you talked about David being David and no losing track of who he is. I think once you do that, once you walk on stage as a comedian and be somebody different from who you are, people spot a fraud straight away and they see that you're insincere and you don't mean what you're saying. Self-deprecation is what makes, for me, what's made comedy the success it is. And growing up in the wee house in Skeeman Airdrie, I mean, the laughs I had when I grew up, it taught me how important humour is and how important it is in dealing with problems and issues. If you can have a laugh, you can cope with anything.
Well, you do get a few laughs in a wee Kunsel Skeeman Airdrie accent, to be honest. And the great secret is, we've all seen people with a big load of money and they're visiting their granny in the wee Kunsel, who's in Airdrie, and they really don't want to go home because it's warm and it's cosy and there's a genuine love about there and there's nonsense to be had and there's plenty of food. Have you noticed that? When people aren't paying massive mortgages, there's aye plenty of food in the house.
Aye, well, they're no staying in Spam Valley, as we used to call it. Couple of posh housing schemes we call Spam Valley. But I mean, the characters that are in about a guy called Jimmy Sweeney who got bit by a dog and said, all the dogs in Airdrie are animals.
Well observed.
Jimmy's best bit of advice was, you can travel the world with an American Express card, but with a brass neck you can go further.
Tremendous. Now, you said that you have the odd bad night, Patrick. What constitutes a bad night for a stand-up comedian?
When nobody laughs, when you go out there and you get... I mean, I ran on stage at Southampton at Jonglers and there was 300 sailors in the audience. And I did an anti-war gag to open up with. The gag was, what's the difference between a British tank driver, a French tank driver and an Iraqi tank driver? I don't care because I'm an American pilot, boom, boom, boom. And there was just this big silence. And for the next 20 minutes, the JCB just dug a bigger and bigger and bigger hole.
Well, no, they were obviously convinced. You were so good, they thought, he's an American pilot.
Shot down in flames, I was.
They thought they were attending a lecture.
Yeah, well, comedy's like that. You go out... I think you know when you've become a reasonable comedian is when you have a bad night and you stick out your 20 minutes, when your bottle doesn't crash and you don't run off stage and you don't start going off at 100 miles an hour. It's keeping that composure and thinking, I've got a job to do here, I need to be professional and I need to do my set, because if there's 100 of the people in the audience not liking that particular night, there'll still be someone there that's enjoying it and you've just got to keep plugging away.
What makes a good stand-up comedian then, actually? Because obviously you've been doing it successfully, regardless of how self-deprecating you are. You know, you've been doing it successfully for many, many years. So you must have, like David, you must have some sort of recipe in your head.
Well, people laugh when I say this, but I think some of us are blessed with this thing where when we go on stage, people go, oh, I'd go out for a pint with a big guy.
Aye.
The big guy looks all right, or a big man's going to be funny. Other people go on stage and they don't come across as well. They don't have that warmth and sincerity. And even when I'm comparing and I'm giving somebody a doing, I do it with a bit of charm and a bit of sincerity and a wee smile, and that goes a long, long way.
Can I say something? You've not got what somebody would call a funny face. You know, I mean, if you'd come in to tell me my granny had died, you know, you could make quite a good professional mourner.
Well, that's nice to have a follow-on career to look forward.
So there's always going to be work. I wouldn't worry about any of that.
No, it's interesting. I was doing some work. I'm not dropping names here, but I was out at Las Vegas 2 years ago doing the Celtic convention, and the people who booked me knew me, but they knew me before I was a comedian. And for the 3 nights in the run up to the gig, Anne and Jackie went, we can't believe you're going to be funny, we're really worried that you're going to crash the whole show. And it gave me a great sense of confidence. But people do look at me and they do find it hard to believe I'm a comedian. I mean, a food taster maybe, but comedian not really.
You're a very funny man. To what extent do you think that, I'm not quite as athletic as I'd like to be. You know, I mean, you're obviously a very fit man, but I mean, to what extent do you think that the comedian has to look just like one of them? Because I mean, you're quite rotund, as I am myself. So I feel qualified to say that. Is that all right?
Well, it's fine. Because I actually had the hassle this morning. I went into Slater's this morning and asked if they had a jacket to fit me, and the guy says, "Look, pal, I haven't got a cubicle to fit you." So it's got its drawbacks. A wee tip for you: it works for me. I use a boomerang to put my belt on in my trousers. That helps.
Well, I was trying to sunbathe in the beach, and the Save the Whale campaign were trying to put me back in the water.
I think the most important thing is that no matter who you are or what you are, that you do have a level of self-deprecation, because no matter how funny you are, there's always going to be someone funnier. No matter how talented you are, there'll be someone talented. And we can all aspire to do what we want to do, but we all need to at all times remember we can do better and we can do more. And I work with accent. Sometimes I sit back and I can be smug and say, I've had great gigs. But I'm down at Jonglers this weekend with a guy called Tom Staden. When I work with people like that, you think, God, I've got a long way to go. And I think that's the secret, working with good quality people and seeing how they're doing and thinking, that's the next level I need to get to.
Feeling you never know it all.
Aye, because comedy, I see comedians all the time, like Frankie Boyle on the telly, Laugh, Darrow O'Brien, Michael McIntyre, and they're sensational. And I'm a wee bit different from them, and as much as I'll go out and I'll quite often have a set, and I'll work to that set unless I'm comparing, I'll do it all off the cuff. But when you see a guy like Michael McIntyre going out and doing 40 minutes just off the cuff, it's a phenomenal talent, and I'm getting better at that, but I'm nowhere near his level, and it's nice to have something to strive to.
To what extent do you think that the telly is, I mean, obviously it's going to lead to higher fees and what have you, but what extent do you think it's good for a stand-up comedy routine, or a stand-up comedy actor, as I like to say? To what extent would you say television is not actually beneficial? I mean, it gets your name and face out there, there's no doubt about that, and that would help with the bookings, but David says he prefers live theatre. Do you prefer a live club setup?
I prefer theatre as well. We do gigs in theatres and they're phenomenal. You do gigs in pubs and they're hard work. The comedy clubs are fabulous, but for me, I do Motherwell Theatre 4 times a year and it's an incredible gig. It's so intimate. 500 people there and you feel like you're sitting in the living room with them. Theatre's wonderful venue for comedy because they've bought tickets specifically to come along for a night at theatre, you see comedy. The problem with TV is once your material's exposed, everyone starts using it.
Yeah.
But I think the good thing about telly is it makes you box clever because, excuse me, you can't get away with cheap gags and you can't get away with just using filth and blue material all the time.
No.
If you're going to be good in the telly, you've got a good writer, you've got to write clever material, and that's not an easy thing to do. And I think some of the people I see, like Frankie Boyle and Dara O'Brien on programmes like Mock the Week, who do push things to the edge, though. But I think they show an incredible talent to come up with so much fresh material.
Yeah, huge. I mean, they're very funny lot. I love these programmes. But there are so many. I mean, like David says, 35,000 actors, 3,000 of them working. There's a lot of very funny people out there that we might not get to hear or see.
Well, it's great when you walk into a pub. There's always a joker sitting in the corner. There's always one in every crowd, someone who can make people laugh. The difference is translating that to walking onto a stage in front of 300-400 people, or driving up to Montrose on a Tuesday night and there's 3 people in the audience, and you've still got to do your gig to get paid. Performance of comedy is very different from being funny, and it's something that you only learn through experience. I had about 2.5-3 years before I get paid, travelling. I mean, I used to fly down to London, pay my own fare, and do 10-minute spots in London just so people would know me so they could book me a year down the line.
Well, don't worry about that, I haven't been paid yet.
I mean, what would they be paying you for, Scott?
Exactly, this is it. I don't know what to bill them for.
Suddenly you'll be hooky shooting your mouth off.
That's like the bumping my gums here. That's wonderful. As somebody once said to me, your life's just like one long phone call, isn't it? Now, let's get on to what you guys are all about here, actually. That's the great performance. So we've got the wonderful comedian, we've got the wonderful actor. Now, Spirit Aid, David, this is your charity, am I right in saying that?
Yeah, with a bunch of friends and colleagues, I set it up in 2001, Scotty. They're no longer with us. We've been going about 8 years. And I'm really proud of where we've reached now. We run projects overseas and at home. We run projects in Afghanistan, Sri Lanka, South Africa, Malawi and Scotland. We're dedicated to children and young people, primarily young people whose lives have been devastated by war or poverty, disease, lack of opportunity, lack of education. And I know that I can put my hand on my heart and say that we honestly, every year, keep thousands of kids alive around the world or improve the quality of their health or their education or their opportunities. And that's not bad for a wee charity based in Glasgow.
You can't say fairer than that. How did it all start? When did it start?
Well, I just think it started because of a bunch of friends and I, we just wanted to make a difference. I mean, I think the world's going to hell in a banana skin, and I'm sure you'd agree. You know, we're destroying the planet faster than we can heal it. We're going to war at the drop of a hat. The gap between rich and poor is getting greater. We're exploiting people. Disease is rife around the world. We've got politicians we no longer trust anymore because they tell us packs of lies, lie through their teeth, or they're caught with...
Well, they tell us the socialists.
Socialist mass. And so we've all got to do something. I think it's incumbent on all of us to do something about it. If we all wish to live in a world of truth and of justice and of peace and abundance for everybody, then we've actually got to break out of our bubbles of apathy and do something about it. And Spirit Aid, I guess, is just one means of expressing that.
What?
And the future of our children, you know, okay, we ain't going to be here forever. There's a great Sioux Nation proverb, the Native American Sioux Indians, and they said, we do not inherit the earth from our ancestors, we borrow it from our children.
Oh, what a wonderful one.
Isn't
that is.
Really,
oh,
really profound, Scotty.
Yes.
So, I ask all the adults out there, if when by the time you get to the end of your life and hand back the world to your children or your grandchildren, what state's it going to be in?
It's a thought, isn't it? You know, I would say this for you, David, curatorial, where are our curatorial politicians that say, no, we must look after this, rather just wreck it to get a headline in the next day's paper?
Yeah, I think something happens in the corridors of power, Scotty, when all, I mean, good, well-meaning people go into politics and somehow they walk along the corridors and they get zapped. They get zapped of every ounce of integrity or of compassion or of common sense, and they end up just being idiots, all towing the party line and taking us off to war. I mean, we went to that horrific war in Iraq, and I think it's a great shame on our names and the people in this country that we went to war in our name, on our watch, and we killed about 1 million Iraqis, destroyed that country, and left it in pieces. That's disgraceful. That should never, ever have happened. We should never have allowed it to happen. You know, people say to me, oh, but 2 million people marched against the war in Iraq. And I said, yeah, well, where the hell were the rest of the 56 million people who could walk and talk and make a conscious thought and decide what kind of world we want to live in? If 20 million people had taken to the streets of Britain against the war with Iraq, do you think Tony Blair would have said yes? No way. No way.
Do you honestly think he wouldn't have said yes? Do you not think it would have come out? He would just have said, look, we're doing it and that's it?
Because, nah, I mean, not if 20 million people had taken to the
really?
Streets, Scotty. No way.
Because we did have, I mean, they went against the Security Council of the UN, didn't it?
Yes, oh, it's an illegal, unjust war. Ridiculous. But anyway, we're not here to talk about the war.
No, but I'm just very interested in the power of protest. I mean, if the power of politics is on the wane, what about the power of protest?
Well, I actually think the world would change the minute we reclaim our power, Scotty. We've given power away to our politicians and the military and the industrial leaders for most of my life, and I think we've got to get power back in the hands of the people. Look what Joanna Lumley, bless her, she's a superstar. I worked with Joanna last year. You know, she has got that wonderful result to allow the Gurkhas to come and settle in Britain, and why not?
I was just saying this morning, why not say we'll have them in Scotland?
Yeah, gladly have them in Scotland. Now, that was one woman's campaign. Okay, she's a high-profile individual, but she has made a genuine difference, and that was a huge result for her. Very, very successful.
I think high-profile individuals do make a difference. I know you are very self-deprecating, and it's very genuine, because you don't see yourself as the superstar that everybody else sees you, and you know, that's such a saving grace. I'm sure that must, you know, by a long way round, actually give you a peace of mind that you probably otherwise wouldn't be able to claim from just the way you are. But you are a superstar now. Being a superstar must make a difference to a campaign.
Yeah, I've often said if I was a bus driver, it would be more difficult on to get the doors open that I knock on or get people to take my phone calls and things. But again, at the end of the day, it's still limited. But yes, it makes a difference. Me being a well-kent face and being on the telly and people know who I am.
You're a well-kent face and people know who you are.
It does make a difference.
Yes.
And at least people know, well, I'm in the public eye. He's not going to run away with the charity's money and buy a BMW and disappear to the Caribbean or something.
That's true.
You know, yes. There is no hiding place.
No, I think you're a lot broader than that, David. Because even if that was what one would do, I can't see how people think that's going to make them happy. You know, you're going to be something. Once you've driven your car around, you're going to find it's the same as any other car, and then you're going to want to come back from the Caribbean. This is why you have to say, you know, these poor bank robbers, you know, that exile themselves from the country, they can't come back.
Do we want them back?
Do we want them back? Absolutely. But it's such a... We've got, in general, a narrowness. I mean, you've summed it up there. I know it's a fun comment, but you've summed it up there. There's a tremendous narrowness about what people think life's about, isn't there? A bigger house or a bigger motor car or something like that.
Scott, if I can just come in at this point.
Yes.
I actually agree with you to a certain extent, but the thing that I've found working with the charity is that the people who have got least are the people who give most to the charity.
Yes.
I mean, some of the rich people that we've contacted and some of the donations that they've given us, when you compare it to what some of the poor people have done, is shocking and quite embarrassing, I think. Although some people say it's great to get anything, but I think a lot of people who don't have much appreciate that giving anything is, as well as being symbolic, the fact that you're helping and you're reaching a hand to show someone else that you care, and that's just as invaluable as the actual giving process. But people are most generous when they have least, and we find that with a charity. You go out and you get old age pensioners coming in and handing money in at the office and things like that, just because they care. So I think,
and they've also known hardship, haven't they?
Well, absolutely, but more than that, the hardship hasn't hardened them. It hasn't hardened their hearts, it's actually softened them and made them realise that a little bit of giving goes a long way, both in helping someone and probably making your own life a little bit better because of that feeling of warmth and sincerity that you've actually done something and you've made a difference. Even though it's such a small difference, it is making a difference.
Now, I'm just looking at the title here as well. You're absolutely right, Pat. There's no doubt about that. I'm looking at the title here, Spirit Aid. Now, this title is quite brilliant because it can be taken on so many levels and so many platforms. But one thing that people are struggling with at the moment is their spirits are in jail. And I'm sure it's something to do with westernisation. You'll know, David, about the Bushmen of the Kalahari.
Uh-huh.
And they had all these tremendous skills, like they could dig up a grub that had poison in it for putting on the tips of the arrows to go hunting, but when the arrows were curing in the sun to cure the poison, they kept the children inside because it was just so dangerous. Now, in a million years, the rest of us wouldn't know how to go about being a Kalahari Bushman. Then they westernised them and brought in sorts of agencies I won't mention, and they became depressed. And a lot of them turned to alcohol and what have you. Now, I'm wondering if we are too westernised these days and our spirits are not free. Does that make any sense?
I think it makes complete sense, Scotty. I think we've had our souls have been ripped out of us. I think this country has lost its soul. I mean, where's the moral leadership coming from to show us a better way? But I think someone like Nelson Mandela is an extraordinary and powerful and elegiac role model for us. Once he's gone, who else is left? You get no British politician that's going to fill that gap. I don't think we talk enough about our spirit, the strength of our spirit, the power of our spirit, our inner energy. We certainly don't. At our peril, we miss it.
And directing it as well. Where are we going to direct our energy and direct our spirit's power? I have a belief that there is a life after death, and because I don't think we'd pick up all this experience just to lie in the cool brown earth and relax. So I think once your shell's gone, your spirit does live on. And whether one believes in God or a God, or there's definitely a power superior to mankind, because I would not like to think that mankind was the ultimate power. But I think...
Oh, no.
I don't think we could, and I wouldn't like to think that, British politicians or whatever were the ultimate power, or the president of the USA was the ultimate power. So that there must be something out there, because collective energy, do you never have, I call it septic, but do you never have, you think about somebody and then the phone goes, is that you, Davey? And you
yes.
think, I was just thinking about you 5 minutes ago.
Oh, you were thinking about someone and suddenly you walk down the street and bang, there they are. They turn around the corner and you haven't seen them for months.
Now, how much of our spiritual energy are we not using?
Oh, I would say about 90%. We use a fraction of the powers that we have. But to go back to where that comes from, Scotty, we're inundated. The multiplicity of television channels, the entertainment channels, the movies, the ads that get us, pumping at us all the time to be thin, to be beautiful, to be rich, to be successful, to be suntanned, to have bling hanging off us. That's a very, very powerful message that's getting out there. And you take someone like David Beckham, Victoria Beckham. They bought their son, their first son, for his third birthday, they bought him a £36,000 Rolex watch.
Right.
Now, David Beckham's a role model. I think he's a fairly nice young man, and I've got nothing against him. But I thought that was disgraceful. What is that saying to mums and dads and three-year-old boys up and down the country? You're nothing unless you've got 36 grand hanging around your wrist before you can even tell the bloody time. It's gotten skewed. I think we've taken our eye off the ball.
Taken our eye off the ball. And our youngsters, like people used to say, why do we buy, when you and I were kids, if your parents could get you a cowboy outfit, or something like that, which had a couple of wee cap guns. Now, I'm just thinking, somebody once said to me, why not buy a violin? Why not buy a banjo, you know, for your kid? Why buy them a gun as a plaything? And it's a similar philosophy, David, to be quite honest with you. It's why not let's do something just a little bit different? And I get quite heartened when I look round the schools. I mean, the schools are beginning to, some schools, like we had the primary school in recently from East Kilbride, and they'd made a CD for Africa.
Oh, fantastic.
Now, this is great thinking, and they'd actually appointed a PR person in the school, one of them. So they had a little PR department and a recording department and all the rest of it under one of their masters. And here was this tremendous little setup. We had all the kids in the studio here, and they'd made a CD to raise money for Africa.
Hey, Scotty, I agree with you. Patrick and I, but we both do a lot of work in schools on behalf of Spirit Aid. We go in there and we give them a sense of, I mean, I talk about the humanitarian work we do. We make films with young people in Scotland, and it's amazing how well they grasp, how eagerly they grasp a hand and get involved in work like that. Couldn't you agree, Patrick? I mean, there's a whole wealth out there.
I'm very fortunate with the Spirit Aid work. I also work in the schools with Albion Rovers, and David and I have forever seen the talent in our schools is phenomenal, but the children are so clever at picking up on what is right and wrong. They've got an instinct to know what is right and wrong, and they try and do the right things. And they're very well led by a lot of great teachers, but even when the teachers aren't leading from the front, the children have got incredible energy and zest to do the right thing. And my only concern about that is I look at the students in our universities and colleges nowadays. It used to be that a lot of change came from the student movement. I mean, I can't remember the last time we had a student protest or students out complaining about the government or complaining about things. We seem to, as a society, have lost that voice of disapproval of our young people standing up and being counted. And I'm just hoping with good reason, because I've been working in the schools, as David said, that the children coming through our schools just now will take us on to a different level, will stand up and say, stop what you're doing, it's wrong, this is the way we should be moving our society forward.
All we had, when you think about it, looking back, and I don't know how the children feel about this now, but the communication side of it again, Davey, the being able to talk, being able to express yourself, because we mentioned this yesterday on the phone, and you don't hear orators anymore. You don't hear somebody standing up and really, you know, saying, I want to change the world, and, you know, somebody like yourself, absolutely ideal, you know, making that impassioned speech. You don't see that in the street anymore.
You don't. I mean, I've been standing up for years saying I want to change the world, Scotty, doing it in public and sticking my neck out, and you get so disheartened at times, and you think, come on, somebody else pick up the mantle, somebody else run with it, along with us. And you sometimes think you're a kind of still, small voice in the wilderness, but actually, we get out there, and I think, as Patrick and I were saying, the best results we get are from young people. To give you an example, we've been working really closely with Rothsay Joint Campus on the Isle of Bute. They're a fantastically progressive school, and right now, over the past year, they've raised us something like £10,000 for our humanitarian work in Malawi. Those children in Rothsay are paying for the feeding program in Malawi. We feed 800 kids a day in Malondi, Malawi. Now, those kids may have a two-hour walk to get to school, 5 hours at school, and a two-hour walk back home. Then they eat for the first time in the day. Because we are providing them a lunch of maize and beans and onions, the kids are now voluntarily staying in school 3 hours every day longer. Now, that's phenomenal, voluntarily.
It's massive.
Because you get food in that belly. Now, that wouldn't be possible without the hard work and the determination of young people on the Isle of Bute. And that's phenomenal. They've taken ownership over that. They've got a partnership with the people in Malondi. They've raised us money. We're just about to put the roof on a youth centre that we built from scratch. And that, I think, will happen next week.
Now,
a women's training workshop. Without the hard work of young people in Rothsay, none of that would have been possible.
It's wonderful. When you go to Malawi, are the children, does their joy overwhelm you?
Oh, you feel very, very humbled. Scotty, I'm always humbled. People would say, it's a hard job to do. Oh, no, it's not a hard job to do. It ain't rocket science. You see someone starving, you see someone who is sick, someone without education or without fresh water or without a roof over their head, you cannot help but be involved and to try and make a difference in their lives. But the joy that you get back, the sense of Oh.
Humanity. Spirit.
Yes, yes, yes. Humanity and spirit. But it's very, very humbling. Very humbling. And we learn, they teach us lessons in human dignity and how human beings can live together in spite of great adversity and dire poverty, but still have dignity and respect for one another and love for their children. Yeah.
The spirit aid that you're putting out there is coming back.
Pardon?
The spirit aid that you're putting out there is coming straight back as spirit aid.
Yes. Well, I believe that what goes around comes around anyway in this world.
Absolutely.
It's interesting, Scotty, just one wee insert here. I think where spirit aid is different from a lot of charities is when guys like David and the rest of the team go out, they actually live in the village with the villagers. They stay in the same conditions, they eat the same, they wash the same way with a cup of water out of a bowl. They live the life that the people live out there. We don't go out and stay in hotels and fly out first class. And David talked there about the summer feeding the 800 children, the £10,000 from Rossi. Every single penny of that £10,000, every single penny gets spent on the projects. Not a penny goes to expenses, salaries or costs. Every single penny given to us for the charity work gets spent on the charity. And I think that's what makes Spirit Aid a unique charity.
Now, hold that thought, folks, because we're coming back to this. If you've just joined us and you're wondering what on earth's going on, you're listening to Scotty McClue's Massive Mighty Megaphone In. We're live on Lanarkshire's L107, Scotland's number one radio station, the big one, the one everyone's talking about, the one everyone's listening to, serving the vast, beautiful, massive and diverse county of Lanarkshire, stretching from the city of Borders to borders of Scotland to the city of Glasgow. I'll just reverse my teeth round again and say that again. Stretching from the Scottish borders to the city of Glasgow. In the studio with me today is the actor David Heyman, who needs no introduction to any of you, and the stand-up comic, who's a very, very interesting and very brilliant and very serious man when he's not being a stand-up comic, Patrick Rulink. They're with me live in the studio. We'll be talking more to them about the charity Spirit Aid. Paul was a master of that.
Tommy Cooper was...
He was just a master anyway, but he was quite exceptional. And somebody told me recently that he probably had a light refreshment before he'd gone on.
Well, I heard the story that one time they went to his dressing room door, 5 minutes, ho-ho, 3 minutes, ho-ho, 2 minutes, ho-ho, 1 minute, ho-ho, and then he came out and went, how did I do?
Well, the one I heard about Tommy Cooper just very briefly was dish towel over the head. He says, dish towel, head, dish towel. And then he takes the dish towel, big flurry, shakes it, goes, head gone. All that nonsense. Now, David, is Spirit Aid, where exactly is Spirit Aid active? I mean, what size of a charity? It's almost outgrown the word charity, hasn't it?
Well, I don't like the word charity. I call it a humanitarian organisation.
Yes.
We're an organisation, Scotty.
Yes.
And we do many things. Like in Afghanistan, we run 2 mobile clinics in the Hindu Kush Mountains that cover all the isolated mountain villages and the refugee camps in the north. Now, each clinic has got a paediatrician, a midwife, a pharmacist and a driver. We also run a small school for 25 pupils. By the way, the areas that we cover with the mobile clinics, they hadn't seen a doctor in 24 years before we got there, and the kids were dying. So in all the communities that we visit, the child mortality rate from preventable diseases has dropped to zero, and that's a phenomenal result for us in a war zone. We were in Sri Lanka after the tsunami. We had 3 teams out there, and we adopted an orphanage that we are still in touch with. In South Africa, we moved into the squatter camp outside of Cape Town called Khayelitsha, where 1.5 million people live in, I mean, serious abject poverty and live in, you know, shacks made of cardboard or plastic or timber. We put in a medical clinic, a youth centre, a soup kitchen, an AIDS orphanage. We built a guest house. We put in running water, solar panels, biogas converter that converts human waste into methane gas that fuels the kitchens of the soup kitchen and the creche. Huge success. And then last year we moved into Malawi, where, as I said, we've got the feeding program, we've got 2 creches that have 100 kids, preschool kids each, and they get a bowl of porridge every morning. We are just about to complete the youth centre, the building of it, and we'll put in as much IT technology as we can for the young people. Obviously we have to put the solar panels in first to energise it, because the Malondi, as a community of 15,000 people, has no electricity and no sanitation. And we've got a women's training workshop. We were training women to knit and sew because they want to make school uniforms and industrial clothing to bring revenue into the community so they can be self-sustaining. We've helped set up an orphanage in the centre of Baghdad. We've been in Kosovo. We've dug a well in Guinea-Bissau in West Africa. In this country, we've got a project called Shooters, where we make short films with young people. Now, over the past 5-6 years, we've probably made about over 40 short films with over 400 young people from 27 different nationalities. And we give them a basic introduction. This is a camera, this is a microphone, this is what a script looks like, this is what an actor does. Then we encourage them to make a short film that they will direct, they will act, they will write, they do everything. All we do is mentor them about an issue that's important to them. There's a very powerful one done by the Rothsay kids called Why Me, which is about bullying. And that's a really, really important little film because, you know, bullying is a major problem in schools. Now, this is giving young kids a voice, and that's a fantastic project. We're really excited by it, and a lot of the times we work with vulnerable communities, communities of vulnerable young people. We also give them lessons in alcohol awareness, drug addiction awareness, sexual health, social responsibility. So it's a very kind of holistic approach to working with these young people. And when they see at the end of the day their movie up there on a big screen, and they invite the mammies, the daddies, the social workers, the teachers and the cops and everybody involved with that young person to come along and see the films up there, we award them, we certificate them, and they're chuffed to bits, and they've got this DVD. No one can take that away from them. No matter what else is missing in their lives, they will have a little bit of self-respect and a little bit of pride because of that achievement.
Wonderful. It's very, very humbling to hear you talk like that, David, but thank you for that. It's just wonderful to hear it. Two things. One is what can we do, and two is there's a big local goings on for Spirit Aid tomorrow night. Is that right? Have I got that right?
You've got that right, Scotty. In Oran Mór, in the west end of Glasgow, the church at the top of Byers Road, which is a great venue, we've got Spirit Aid 2009 Gala Night. We've got comedians, we have musicians and bands. The MC is going to be Des Clark, the comedian. We have Ricky Warwick of the Almighty. We get Graham Clark of the Wet Wet Wets. We have Craig Armstrong, who's a Golden Globe winning film composer. He composed the music for Moulin Rouge. He did bits of Lion King, the Ray Charles movie, Shrek, I think, or The Hulk. And he rarely performs in public, and he's going to perform for us. Maeve McKinnon, who's a young Gaelic singer, she got the Up and Coming Artist of the Year Award in 2007. She's going to sing with us. Nikita Angus, the X Factor finalist, remember the young lassie from Glasgow, who's one of our Spirit Aid kids. She came through the Spirit Aid youth team a couple of years ago. She's coming along. Jill Jackson, who from Speedway, ex-Speedway singer. Christine Bovo, who's a wonderful young singer. She sings Edith Piaf, she sings Bob Dylan, she sings Leonard Cohen. Maeve O'Boyle, an up-and-coming young star. John Reed, ex of the Nightcrawlers, who's now a famous songwriter. He wrote Leona Lewis's number one worldwide hit. He's flying in from Los Angeles to play for us. Easy Orchestra. And of course, Patrick Rolick, here sitting on my left here.
Fantastic. Flow in the kicks.
So this is for a fund. This is basically for fundraising and spreading the word about Spirit Aid.
Yep, all proceedings from the fundraiser will go towards the projects at home and abroad.
Go towards our projects, you betcha.
So don't forget your wallet. It's 15 quid a skull to get in to Oran Mór. Now, Oran Mór's the big church at the top of, a big former church at the top of Byers Road. Just at the corner at where you used to cross to Queen Margaret Drive, isn't it? To the BBC there.
Yes.
So just on the corner there, and it starts at 7:30 tomorrow night. That's Thursday, the 7th of May. The doors are open at 7 o'clock, and there'll be light refreshments. I take it, David, they've got the bar there.
Oh yes, there's a bar there. Absolutely, you can drink yourself silly if you so wish. We have some auctions, we have some raffles, we've got some great raffle prizes as well. It should be a great fun.
It'll
night.
It'll be a wonderful be fun
a
night.
Musical
yeah,
celebration.
Yeah. Right, everybody, get yourself along to Oran Mór tomorrow night. Doors open 7 o'clock, 7:30 it starts, it's 15 quid, and it's an absolute top bill there. You'll see, and you'll get to see David Heyman as well, which is...
Oh yes, and I'm going to be up there talking about Spirit Aid.
Fantastic.
And tickets can be had from theticketweb.co.uk or from Oran Mór. or on the door tomorrow night.
So we call to Oran Moore and get yourself sorted out there. Marvellous stuff. 7 o'clock, doors open for 7:30, 15 quid, Oran Moore tomorrow night. Any trouble, see David Heyman.
Scotty,
he'll have started it.
Scotty, if there's anyone listening today that would like to make a donation or help the charity out, they can call our office in Glasgow. The number's 0141 552 6111.
I'll just make a note of that again.
0141 552 6111. And if I can just say one final thing that I think differentiates us from all other charities, when we did work out after the tsunami and when we did the mobile ambulances in Afghanistan, David actually went over there and took the money with him in US dollars up his juke and spent the money in the local villages. So we actually invested the money people in Scotland had given to us, and we invested it in the local community rather than buying all the stuff here and paying to take it over. Bought it all locally, helped local traders and helped local business, and that's part of what we try and do, is make everything we do sustainable for local communities throughout the world.
Can I just say, in thanking you so much for coming and joining us today, David Heyman and Patrick Rowling, don't believe what the Mirror says, because you guys are beautiful.
Mirror speaks very highly of you.
Will you come back and see us sometime?
Oh, I don't. What do you think, Patrick?
Probably.
Yeah, probably.
Right.
We will gladly come back.
I won't push you for an answer just now. Thank you so much, and all the very, very best tomorrow night. All the very, very best for the future for Spirit Aid. And thank you to all of you and the team for so much that you do for so many beautiful people. Thanks
Scotty,
so much.
Thank you, and thank you for having us on your wonderful show.
Great pleasure. Dinky-doo!